Hello everyone and welcome to today's webinar by Homeopathy 360. A warm afternoon to our esteemed guests and colleagues present with us right now. Hope you all are safe in this lockdown period. For all of you and who have already joined, I heartily welcome you all. I, Dr. Yashika Arora, will be the moderator of today's session for all of you. So before we begin, I would like to introduce you to the members of my team who will be working behind the scenes while we conduct this webinar. Dr. Rajesh Kumar, I welcome you, sir. He'll be with us at the backend system to ensure that the webinar runs smooth. Welcome, Dr. Rajesh.
Thank you, Dr. Yashika.
Also, I would like to guide people that you have a chat box on the upper right corner of your screen where you can type your questions and send to us by pressing button next to the box. And not testing much of your patience, before starting this session, I would like to introduce you to BJI's educational platform, that is Homeopathy 360, the treasury of knowledge and hidden talent. It is one of the most updated portals for online publication of all kinds of course material. We've tried to update you always with the latest news, latest events, upcoming events, career opportunities, jobs, job vacancies all over the world, all over the country, research updates, whatever updates regarding homeopathy is there all over the world. Articles from great classical and contemporary practitioners, old archives, articles from upcoming homeopaths, case studies, periodic literature, our journals like Homeopathic Heritage and Homeobuzz, various types of videos of great stalwarts and great homeopathic practitioners. We have always tried to connect homeopaths all over the world to broadcast their talent. Plus, it has we try that Homeopathy 360 has always been an exceptional education hub for all generations of homeopaths. I also would like to invite all the homeopaths present with us right now to contribute your knowledge and experiences in the core area of your expertise. And you may contact us on www.homeopathy360.com for the same and contribute to the fraternity as per your area of expertise so that we can make it universally accessible all over the world. And also I would like to update our viewers that we'll be running a question answer session at the end of the webinar where you can clarify your queries with both the speakers. You can also raise your hand on the upper right corner of your screen. You can see an option of raising your hand to ask your questions. So I hope I'm clear to everyone and I've briefed everything about the webinar. So now be attentive. Now we'll begin with the lectures. First of all, I would like to introduce you to the dignified speakers of today's webinar. The first speaker we have is Dr. Aarti S. Khalatkar. She is the professor and HOD of Department of Homeopathic Pharmacy from Lokmanya Homeopathic Medical College, Pune, Maharashtra. I welcome you, ma'am. I hope I'm audible to you. Her topic of discussion would be concept of placebo in homeopathy. That is a very good topic and one of the favorite topics of all homeopaths. So she'll be discussing what is placebo exactly, why it is being used, opinions of different stalwarts regarding placebo, importance of same in clinical practice, plus she'll be covering this topic as per the syllabus of BHMS curriculum. That's great. And so I welcome you, ma'am. Now I hand over the session to you. Please begin.
Dr. Aarti, I request you to please have a mic and start your presentation. Dr. Aarti, ma'am, I believe you are able to hear me. You are not yet audible. You are not yet audible, ma'am. Kindly. I request you PT and please check your audio so that our audience will get the view of your PPT and your content.
This is Dr. Aarti audible now?
Dr. Aarti, can you hear us? Your voice is not visible.
Dr. Aarti, ma'am, please, I request you to please turn off your earphones and just speak as it like without earphones. It would be audible. I think that
you can plug off your microphone. Yes, now it is very much
Can you hear me now?
Yes, your voice is very clear. Yes,
thank you.
So, dear doctors and dear students, I welcome Dr. Aarti ma'am again. And now she start the presentation. Kindly have your patience and let's start the webinar again.
Thank you, sir. Respected dignitaries, all the faculty, all the teachers, and my dear students, a very good afternoon to one and all. Today, in fact of being shut down, locked down, social distancing, we all have come together under one roof for well connectivity. And this is only and only because of the digital technological surveys and homeopathy 360 who has taken the initiative to bring us all together under one roof. So our teaching and learning process does not stop. Therefore, first of all, I would like to thank all the organizers of Homeopathy 360. I liked their logo, You Think and We Link. And a big thank you to whole team of Homeopathy 360 who have arranged and brought us under this particular one big national webinar platform. Thank you, team. Thank you, Dr. Manish sir, Dr. Ranjendra sir, Dr. Yashika madam, Mr. Sharma sir, and whole team. Thank you, madam. I would now like to thank our respected management, our principal, my teachers, my colleagues, and my departmental staff, and my students, without whom it was not possible for me to be here. Thank you very much. Now we shall start with our session by paying a homage to our great grandmaster, Dr. Samuel Hahnemann, who was a legend by himself, a true legend, a legend who could move the mountains. So let us pay a tribute to him and start our seminar. I would like to share the screen now. Hello.
Dr. Aarti, your screen is shared. Yes. You can continue further.
Yes. Yeah. Can I start with my presentation, sir?
Yes, you can.
Hello.
Everyone is able to see your screen. Everyone is able to see your screen and your voice is very audible. Yes.
Thank you very much, sir. So now we start with our session of concept of placebo. Now students, you might be wondering that why this concept of placebo has been kept for the syllabus right from first year. You're right. This would help us to make us more enhanced and more better clinically as we go on for the higher years. Now, if you see the left-hand side image very carefully, you can see there are few globules and an amber-colored bottle. These globules, if you see from far distance, you would not be able to make whether this particular globule is medicated or unmedicated. And this is what we need to learn here. All medicines look alike in homeopathy. Now let us see what exactly do we mean by placebo. give students a placebo, when we go to the topic name, concept of placebo. Why is it called a concept? Concept is an idea or a particular principle to be followed. So here we are going to study what exactly is a placebo. A placebo is often referred to as inert pill, that is a medicinal carrier that resembles a medical drug, but does not contain any active ingredient. If I'm not wrong, my students might have been going back to their vehicle chapter, where we had studied a vehicle is a chemically neutral substance which is intended to carry the dynamic power of the drug within the interior of the human organism in order to fight with the disease. Yes, it definitely resembles the vehicle. So it is identical to the actual drug, that is indistinguishable by the optic, olfactory, gustatory, or palpable senses. Yet it lacks the medicinal component. In this image, students, you can see that we have files filled with globules, and another one, we have got fresh sugar of milk powder. It can also be defined as pharmacologically and pharmacodynamically inactive substance. Even in my previous slide, I had told you it is definitely inert, no action, inactive substance. So what is a placebo as per Stedman's Medical Dictionary? The word placebo originates from a Latin verb meaning I shall please. I repeat again, a Latin verb meaning I shall please. It has two meanings. First, a placebo may be an inner substance which is prescribed for a suggestive value. Whereas secondly, it can be an inner substance which is identical in appearance with the compound or the drug being tested in the experimental research, and the use of which may or may not be known by the physician or the patient. Now here in the forthcoming slides, we will see how it is used in the drug proving trials. It is given to distinguish between the action of the drug and the suggestive effect of the drug under the study. Now please, students, have a very keen look at this particular image. Is it something like this? Please have a keen look. Or is it like this? Yes, it can be like this. A skillful use, the right use, the right method, the right time, it can be like this. So when we give a placebo, students, it has got a particular effect. Now, this is an additional information which I'm trying to give you. It has got two types of responses. One, a beneficial response, which is called as placebo response, whereas the other, a side effect to the same inner substance, which is called as nocebo response. So we have learned today what is a placebo response and a nocebo response. All these are very important in the drug proving trials. Now let's go back a bit towards the historical scripts of placebo. The first scientific demonstration of placebo effect was discovered in 1799 by a British physician, John Haygarth. The word placebo was used in a medicinal context in the late 18th century to describe a commonplace method or medicine, and in 1811, it was defined as any medicine adapted, this is very important, to please than to benefit the patient. So we would see the exact meaning of this. The placebos have featured in the latest literature, if you would like to have, in 1955 and 2011, in the medical use until well into the 20th century. Henry Beecher in 1955 published an influential paper entitled The Powerful Placebo, which proposed the idea that placebo effects were clinically important. That's what I said in the previous slides, that clinically it is more important. In 2011, Benedetti, he stated that a real placebo effect is a psychobiological phenomena. Please pay attention to this. It is a psychobiological phenomena which occurs in the patient's brain after the administration of the inner substance. So now we go on for the doctrine of placebo. Now, as I told you, it is originated from Latin word placere, which means to please. So the future tense of placebo meaning I shall please. I would like to repeat again, I shall please. Now, our master, Dr. Samuel Hahnemann, indeed was the first physician who administered the placebos to his patient on a systematic and regular basis in homeopathy. No wonder he was the pioneer. Now, in most instances, Dr. Hahnemann marked placebos with the paragraph symbol as given here. Let us see the reason and the rationale behind this practice. The rationale behind this practice was that Master Hahnemann had encountered the well-known problem. And what was that problem? During those times, the patients used to take medicines on and off on a daily basis, as it was very typical. The main reason for giving placebo was, therefore, to please the impatient patient. To please the impatient patient who was used to frequent medications in allopathic medicines, not only every day, but sometimes also hourly. Can you imagine? Hourly. So regarding placebo usage, Dr. Hahnemann, our master, has given the details stating in three different aphorisms very clearly. In the fifth edition of Organon of Medicine, in aphorism number 91 and 96, whereas in the sixth edition of Organon of Medicine, aphorism number 281. In the next slide, we will see exactly the own words of our master. I will read out as it is. In order to be convinced, we are at aphorism number 281, sixth edition of Organon of Medicine. In order to be convinced of this, the patient is left without any medicine for 8, 10 of the 15 days, meanwhile giving him only some powders of sugar of milk. Very clearly it is written, some powders of sugar of milk. If the few last complaints are due to the medicine, simulating the former original disease symptoms, then these complaints will disappear in a few days or hours. If during these days, without medicine, while continuing good hygienic regulations, nothing more of the original disease is seen, he is probably cured. So clearly it is mentioned in aphorism number 281 of 6th edition of Organon of Medicine. Dear students, in pharmacy, many a times we have come across the question, relation of homeopathic pharmacy with that of Organon of Medicine. This is how you start correlating with the various aphorisms. Now let us see the concept as per Dr. Stuart Close. Let us see in his own words. Dr. Stuart Close, in his own words, in the very beautiful book he has written, The Genius of Homeopathy, he starts his chapter of placebo with this. And what is it? One of the distinguishing characteristics of a great painter is that he knows when to stop. We are going to see this in details. I repeat again. One of the distinguishing characteristics of a great painter is that he knows when to stop. Many a painting would have been great if the artist had known when to stop. It is in his own words. It goes even with the physician. How? Let's see. When in his anxiety to perfect, he may rob his work of its vitality. The problem here is to give just enough medicines and not too much. I repeat again, the problem here is to give enough medicine and not too much. Hence, concept of placebo was given to satisfy the patient. Now let us see the use of placebo in prescription. Now almost the whole of the portion of pharmacy is completed by now, and we are on the verge of completion even of prescription writing. So you might be knowing what is prescription writing. So let us see how the placebo has been used in prescription. It has been an indispensable part in the clinical practice for almost every physician. So almost every physician uses it. It has been advised by Dr. Hahnemann and advocated by other stalwarts under special circumstances. Since the inception of homeopathy, we can use placebo in the prescription. Now, if we have a close look at Dr. Hahnemann's case journals, it too will reveal that there have been placebo prescriptions. Now, the best part of it, the synonyms for placebo, because we need to maintain the confidentiality. Therefore, we need to have different names too. So let us see what are the different names of placebo. The first one goes by Phytum. Second one goes by Lactopen. Third one, Nihilinum. And fourth one, Rubrum. The last one is very commonly used in our practice. I repeat again, Phytum, Lactopen, Nihilinum, and Rubrum. So in homeopathy, according to Dr. Stuart Close, he has called this placebo as second best remedy in the Materia Medica. And he says it in his own words, without which no good homeopathist could long practice medicine. So clearly it has been mentioned, it is the second best remedy in the Materia Medica. So apart from all these, we can also have one more name as second best remedy. We will see again, in his own words, Dr. Stuart Close states, one of the distinguishing characteristics of a great painter is that he knows when to stop. And this is how we explicit. When the physician does not like to administer any homeopathic medicine to his patient, it may happen, students. There may be times when the physician does not want to administer any medicine to the patient. Or in other words, there is no necessity for administration of any medicine. What does the physician do? The physician in this case administers unmedicated substance, or in other words, vehicle, because now we are learning homeopathic pharmacy, so we need to know this as well. So vehicle to satisfy the patient and thereby create confidence that he has been taking medicine regularly. How beautifully it has been explicited. Now let us see, since we are into homeopathic pharmacy, we need to know the details of the unmedicated substances which are used as placebo. As usual, just like vehicles, they are also of two types. Over here, students, we are not going to involve semi-solid. We have got two, solid and liquid. So let us see in details the solid unmedicated substances which can be used as placebo. The first and foremost is sugar of milk. All of you know by now, C12, H22, O11, H2O, it's also known as SL. Also, it can be called as saccharum lactis. It can be known as lactose. In the second place, we have got cane sugar, which is called as sucrose or sucrosum. In the third place, we have globules. In the fourth, tablets. In the fifth, we have tabloids, and in the sixth, we have cones. Whereas in the liquids, you can see on the right-hand side, vial enclosed with a transparent liquid. It may be ethyl alcohol. It can be purified water. It can be aqua distillata or distilled water. You've seen how distilled water is prepared. Or it can be purified water with alcohol. So all these liquids can be ensured to be used, one of the either, in the form of placebo. Now let us see what is the exact utility of placebo in homeopathy. When a well-selected remedy continues its action, we should not disturb the case, may it be in acute or may it be in chronic. Disturb, we are not going to disturb it, because we have already selected the remedy in quite fine time. We have taken long time of pains, we have taken efforts, so we are not going to disturb it. Now at this time, what to do? At this time, we need to give placebo to the patient. Why? To keep up the action of the medicine undisturbed. So what is this help to, or what it is going to help? It is going to give a feeling of gratification to the patient, because he knows he is taking medicine. So it is a psychological effect. And thereby, the case remains undisturbed and the well-selected remedy continues its action. Next, Dr. Hahnemann has advised that the remedy should be stopped as soon as the improvement appears. Now, this is, everybody has been going through this and everybody knows this. Now, when the improvement begins, we seize the medication. This is a dictum. Now, at this time, we simply substitute Saclac. Why? As a remedy, because it will act as a supplement to the indicated remedy. So here, he advises to give Saclac powders to last long during the intervals, between the visits, but advises to be sure to moisten the tablets with alcohol, or put some small amount of unmedicated pellets also in the Saclac powder, because there are some patients who have a way of investigating the powders too. If they find no pellets, they will become suspicious. So we have to be very, very careful. Now, one more utility. When the patient comes to the physician after being overdrugged from many types of systems, may it be allopathic or homeopathic or any system, the case may not give a clear indication for the selection of similibum. Yes, dear students, this sometimes the physician does come towards such problems. So at this time, what do we need to do? This is the time when we can prescribe placebo for a period of fortnight and see the amount of joy you can find on the face of the patient. So this is the use of placebo. Now, most of the homeopathic medicines, one more important use, most of the homeopathic medicines, students, it starts with a slight homeopathic aggravation. I think by now everybody knows what is a homeopathic aggravation. Now, during this period, some patients may come to physician being disturbed of this effect. There are some patients who may not be able to gulp it. There are patients who may not be able to take it so easily. They are disturbed and so they come to the physician. Now, in such circumstances, the physicians conspicuously needs to avoid giving medicine to the patient, and thereby he will give a placebo for the satiety or the satisfaction, as this type of aggravation will subside within some time. We know, as a homeopathic physician, we know homeopathic aggravation is definitely going to subside after some time. So we are going to give a placebo. Now, sometimes it can be given to the patients who expect and demand medicine. Yes, there are patients. They will expect also, and they will, if it is not fulfilled, they will demand the medicine. So when actually they do not need this, they are not in need with it, but they will not be satisfied until they have been given some. Okay. So sometimes placebo is required for those patients just to feel better. Can you see the image put up over here? Just to feel better, the placebo is given and then they will be satisfied because they have a feeling that they have got some illness. Actually, they do not have. Is just an imaginary, when actually they do not suffer from it. But still, if a dose of placebo is given to the patient feels satiated. Now, one more utility of placebo. Indisposition. All of us know what is indisposition. It is a category of illness due to some exciting cause. Now, dear students, everybody right from first to final year knows what is indisposition. What are the exciting causes? The common exciting causes may be continuous exposure to strong odors, presence of foreign bodies, improper hygiene, poor sanitation, living in a damp or ill-ventilated house, irregular or improper diet, or a lack of exercise. You can just see the image below which has been put up. So all these are due to some type of exciting cause. Now, in such cases where no medication is required, just the removal of causative or maintaining factor will set the things all right for the patient. For example, apart from this, I can give you some examples related with faulty lifestyle. You can see on the left hand side, overexertion of mind and body, lack of adequate sleep, lack of open air, lack of exercises, inadequate intake of water, and personal hygienic issues. All these are just the, if the causative factors are removed, everything will be all right. So in such cases, just a dose of placebo would be sufficing. Now, we all have been learning homeopathic posology. Homeopathic pharmacy includes all the posological principles. So as per the law of minimum dose, we give minimum quantity of the medicine to the patient. Everybody knows what is law of minimum. Kindly see at the both the images. Minimum quantity ke upar hi hum bharosa karte hain. At this time, when the patient feels more quantity needs to be given, yes, sometimes patients are of different constitutions. The patient will feel that more amount of quantity is needed. I want more number of placebos. At that time, you will be giving placebos. You understand what I'm saying? So please do not give medications. Stay safe, stay healthy. Give placebo doses along with the required medicine. You can see these images have been conspicuously been put over here so that you will understand the concept. The conceptology is very important, students. Now, as per Dr. Stuart Lowe's, the remedy needs to be given when sure about it. At times, when the physician is not sure about the remedy, dear students, there are chances when sometimes the physician is not sure about the remedy. So the physician has to think. He needs to take pains. He will contemplate. He makes a thorough re-examination again. And this shows his real interest in the case. And he inspires the confidence within the patient. Can you see with what confidence the doctor has given the patient? And the patient is absolutely gratified. Gratification is a very good word for this. So this is how we can use the placebo in homeopathy. One of the most important utility of placebo is drug proving. Now, all of you know what is drug proving. Drug proving is a systematic, orderly way of investigation of the pathogenetic powers within the healthy human beings. Now, when we are doing single blind trials, double blind trials, we need to have placebo as well with us. We have been all learning. So placebos are often used in drug proving trials as an inactive control. Why? So that the physician can better evaluate the true, genuine overall effect of the experimental drug under treatment or study. So placebos in drug proving, they serve a very important role. Their responses help. Why? They will help to provide a good, what you can say, measure to the actual effect of the drug being tested. So one can be in a control and one can be the drug. So it will provide, in other words, important baseline with which to compare the treatment group. So in fact, this particular topic has engulfed maximum all the topics of homeopathic pharmacy, drug proving, posology, prescription, minimum dose, everything. So that is why this is a very important utility. Now, if there are utilities, there are definitely the precautions you need to take likewise. So what are the precautions while dispensing? First, identification of placebo must not be disclosed, dear students, in any form, even in the prescription. This is confidential. Labeling must be precise. This is very important. Because labeling, we have also learned this in the drug and cosmetic law. Rule 9A, if you remember, labeling and packing of medicines. We can add sugar of milk or saccharum lactis along with nihilinum, lactopin, and rubrum list so that nobody will come to know this. So we need to add SL also. Otherwise, people will start thinking SL, lactopin, and rubrum is the same. So we need to add SL equally to the prescription or the whatever is the intent we are giving. Most important, skillful use. Dear students, we have seen so many utilities. We have seen the concept behind the placebos. But equally, now it is upon you and physicians how to use it. So it is important for every student to have a perfect understanding of the concept and skillful use of same. They must be able to defend why and how we use it. Because as it is homeopathy, it may be criticized saying medicines are placebo. But we have to be strong. We must be confident. We must be confident enough to defend the utility and the fact. Because we are correct. We should know when, why, and how to use it. We should be able to make a proper judgment. So prescribe placebo with confidence, students. Yes, indeed. A placebo has been rightly said as the second best remedy for all the young homeopaths like you. It's the best friend. And of course, the old doctor's reliance and very present help in the time of trouble. So therefore, we can definitely call the placebo as a wonderful friend indeed, who will never distrust you. So I hope all of you have understood the concept behind our wonderful friend placebo. I thank the organizers once again. I thank Dr. Pal sir to be with us over here, and thank you, my dear students, to be here with one and all, good unity, with the attitude of having teaching learning attitudes. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much. I would like to inform everybody that the questions we'll be discussing in the end of the lecture after Dr. Prabhas Pal, our next speaker, who will be here soon. He'll be explaining everything. So thank you so much, ma'am, mm-hmm. for your effort and such a nice presentation on placebo. Thank you. You've discussed each and every point, and I hope everybody has enjoyed and they have asked many questions we'll be discussing in the end. I've noted down. So without wasting any more time, sure. I would like to introduce our next speaker. He's one of the one of an inspiration for people. So we have Dr. Prabhas Pal with us. He's the professor and head of Department of Pharmacy, JIMS College, Hyderabad, Telangana. And his topic of discussion would be potentization. He'll be discussing the dynamic power comparisons between the dynamization in the effect and process of potentization. So I welcome you, sir, to our platform, and please proceed with the session.
Thank you, Madam Dr. Arora. And at the outset, I thank organizers for giving me an opportunity to share my expertise on this platform. Good evening to participants and all viewers. Today my topic is for discussion is dynamization or potentization. Potentization is very dear to homeopathy and its concerned people, you know, but it is at the same time is very critical and disputable to the rest of the world, because you know this potentization does not fit to the paradigm of science. Modern science could neither gauge the dimension of potent dynamization, nor they could break open the mystery of potentization. From the point of view of mechanics, potentization is a very simple technique. But from the viewpoint of physicochemistry, physics and chemistry, it's a hard nut to crack. That is why modern science could not prove nor disprove the homeopathy and its the concept and theory of potentization. Master Samuel Hahnemann, you know, the creator, I call him creator of this. Had Master Samuel Hahnemann not born, homeopathy would have not come to the existence. And homeopathy stood by the theory and concept of potentization. This potentization has not suddenly came from the heaven to the Hahnemann's mind. He was continuously experimenting. When he was practicing with the original crude drug substance in a in the conventional way that days, which are medicines are available those days. Then he, when he found, noticed severe amount of aggravations from most of the patients, he started contemplating deeply what to do, how to solve these problems. Then he started reducing the quantity of the original substance. Still it was, he was not satisfied. Then he started diluting the medicines with the water or alcohol. He noticed that now that aggravations from the patient sides, they are not reporting so much. It is less now, it is reduced, but still expected results Hanuman was not getting. So while experimenting, Hanuman started potentizing this. He started applying this technique. I will come later to this session about the technique of potentizations. But he realized that these potentized remedies act very differently from those that remain in their original material. He also noticed these remedies become so powerful that when they reach higher potencies, high and higher potencies, they keep on showing their array of actions on the human body and bringing the patients to the path of pathway of the cure. He was astonished, and then he stopped using the medicine, homeopathic medicine those days in original material, original form, in crude form, and he kept on using only potentized medicines. This is the way how potentization became as a signature of homeopathy. You know, if potentization is the actually central pillar of the system of homeopathy or science of homeopathy. What happens during potentizations? This thing, actually medicines begin with the material structure of the substance, then in the process this material structure can gradually fades away and its energetic power emerges. That's how the dynamic power is magnified. And what is dynamic power? This we must understand. What is dynamic power to learn this topic of potentizations or dynamizations? Dynamization is something very much related to the dynamicity, dynamic power. Dynamic power is, you can refer this Master Samuel Hanuman's Organon of Medicine, 5th or 6th editions, 11th aphorism, footnote, where Hanuman has elaborately described about the dynamic power. It is immaterial, invisible, and pure energy. Through the dynamic power, it influences one substance on another by its intrinsic, inherent, and immanent force. This dynamic power, it's a process actually where one substance acts on another substance without communication or actual interchange of the material parts of the substance. I give you an example. Just a man, suppose, walking on the roadside. Then he suddenly felt nausea or vomiting because some smell came from the nearby dustbin, and he felt nausea. Nothing came from the dustbin to enter into his nose, but still he felt nausea, vomiting. There is no actual interchange, communication of the material substance here, but through the smell he felt nausea, vomiting. You know, the sun is very far away from earth, but we can see the presence of light. No particle comes directly from the sun, but when it falls, light ray falls on a book, we can read the lines. So this kind of, this is dynamic something, dynamic power, which is just an energy form. Through this dynamic power, this one substance attracts another inseparably. It makes the intimate communications between them in such a manner that it cannot be diminished or disappeared by just dilutions. So when we potentize medicines, the solvent or solutions become so intimate, the substances with the solvent, that we cannot reduce its power even by mixing with the water for the dilution. It is so powerful. Now come to the dynamization. It's a series of dilutions and agitations in a very specialized manner. You see the one here, first bottle is there. One bottle, from there you take one part, mix with the alcohol in the second bottle, and then shake, agitate. Give 10 strokes and becomes potentized. You get first potency. See that original substance, mother tincture, is diluted 10 times here or 100 times here. Then again, from the second bottle, you take one part and mix in the third part, third bottle. Same way, you potentize, and you will see that power is increased to now potency number 2, second potency. Like that, third potency, fourth potency, any number of potency you can raise. So here, what is happening here? From the first bottle, when we reach to the second or third bottle, the original substance is gradually diminishing in quantity, but its quality is increasing enormously. Our homeopathic pharmacopoeia defines potentization is a mathematico-mechanical process. Both mathematics and mechanics is there, by which the inherent and latent dynamic of curative power of crude drugs is aroused or increased by modifying drug power to dynamic power. The drug power, what is the original material substance, is turned into immaterial substance through the dynamic power, through simultaneous and successive process of dilution and friction in definite order. Now, what is the difference between two things I am telling? One is one-time dilution, and next time I am telling about the dynamization. What is the difference between these two? See, the mere dilution, simple dilution, just if you take sugar and mix with water, the sugar will be diluted. Then again, you put more water into the same bottle, the same tumbler, you will see that more volume will be increasing the solvent, and it will be continuously diluted. But what will happen, that sweetness of the sugar will reduce. More and more water, if you put, sweetness of the sugar will reduce. This is just dilution. But dynamization, here quantitative reduction, as I gave the first previous slides, that quantitatively how it is reducing when you are giving strokes in a definite manner, when you are potentizing, its quantity is reducing, its physical properties losing, but strength will enormously increase. By that increased strength, it can alter health in a tremendous manner. It can change the person, in a diseased person, to the, bring to the cure. So the difference between dilution is and dynamization is, one is dilution is the quantitative increase and dynamization qualitative increase. This is the basic difference. Now, how get the effect of potentization? What is that effect? I already told that quantitatively it is reducing constantly drug substance, happening that quantitative reductions. And by this, as quantitative reduction is happening, so aggravation of dose is being minimized. What Hahnemann wanted, that Hahnemann expected, that this, their patient should not have aggravation. By this potentizations only we can minimize these aggravations. So by that, not only that aggravation is diminished by the time minimized, but its quality also is being increased. Therapeutic quality, therapeutic activity is increased because this range of actions of the drug substance is being increased. So I'll give example, suppose acid. Acid, you know, if it falls on the skin, it can burn. Severely can burn. When you dilute the water, its burning will reduce. Keep on diluting, at some point of time there will be no burning. But if you potentize, then what will happen? This will start producing symptom like weakness, or the general lack of general depression, general vitality changes in the mental and emotional level, changes in the digestive tract, so many places, kidney, blood, and so many areas, so many organisms, it can touch, it can produce its effect. So you can see that how mere acid, which was just burning in the beginning, now after potentizing, it can produce so many symptoms. Inert substance be potent. Take example, just like algae or fungi or some roots or some bark or something like that, the spores. These are all just inert substance. We do not, people don't know much about its any power, therapeutic power or any power, but they become highly potent when they are potentized. When you potentize toxic substance, this is a great discovery of Hahnemann, great contribution of Hahnemann. And you can say there is lots of contribution of homeopathy to the modern science, though modern science always denies homeopathy, always the ridicule at homeopathy, but they can't deny these contributions of homeopathy to the fundamental science, to the basic science, like toxicity of the drug, how it can be eliminated. That was done by Hahnemann by the process of potentizations. He made the drug into the dynamic, these potentizations can be converted into the dynamic form, that is the dynamic energy is emerged, and by that dynamic power only these homeopathic medicines work. It can increase in the range of drug actions. Drug actions, I already give you example that how it increases the range of actions, drug actions. So it can purify this actual main motto of potentization. You can say it basically it purifies, it removes the purification. In the beginning of the definition of dynamic power, I said it is pure energy. So this homeopathic potentization makes a substance very pure, non-toxic, non-poisonous, very pure. So the purity of the drug when you get, then it works better. Now this potentization is done by two processes. One is trituration, other one is succussion. Now what is trituration? It's a physical process by which grinding of one medicinal substance, insoluble medicinal substance is done with a non-medicinal material like sugar or milk, using a pestle and mortar in a specific manner, in a precise and documented manner. So one medicinal substance, one insoluble medicinal substance, which does not dissolve in any liquid like water, alcohol or glycerin or oil, any liquid, it does not dissolve. So that kind of insoluble medicinal substance is grinded with a non-medicinal substance like sugar or milk in a mortar then we can triangulate. Some of the factors which affect the triangulations, while triangulating, we must remember, keep in mind these factors like hardness. If material substance is drug is very hard, like metal, you know, metals are metal, hard metal is difficult to break. Triangulation is done, technique of triangulation adapts to the pulverizing, grinding of the substance. So grinding of the metal is very difficult, you know. So if it is very hard, so triangulation will be difficult, its quality may suffer. Similarly, toughness, as for example rubber, it's a tough, it can stretch, but it is difficult to break, difficult to attenuate. That's why prototyping is also called attenuation. You cannot make it into several pieces, that rubber. Similarly, stickiness of some substance like resinous substances which are gummy in nature, again difficulty we face during triangulations. Similarly, temperature, like softening temperature, in waxy substances which melts in the presence of heat during triangulation. You know, while triangulating, when grinding, well, what is happening in the theory of physics, that Brownian movement takes place between the molecules, inside the molecules. So heat is emanating. By this emanating heat, it's a waxy substance, it will be melted. So again, it will be difficult to triangulate. Similarly, if watery content is there, suppose some substance which attracts water, then it will be difficult again to, because that will form the crystal or clusters. This sugar or milk particle will be clouded, so it will be difficult to triangulate. So these factors, hardness, toughness, stickiness, softening temperature and moisture content, should be kept in mind during the triangulation. Now see the procedure. What is the procedure? We take a mortar and pestle. In that we take drug, one part of the drug. You know that this potentization is done on the basis of two scales, decimal scale or centesimal scale. There is another scale also, LM scale, that is for higher potentizations. Higher potentizations like 0/1, 0/2, very high dilution, 1/50,000 dilutions. That also initially we have to do the triangulations. Triangulation first three potencies. After that only we do potentizations in a liquid form. But anyway, first potencies what we make triangulations. That is done basically in two scale, either in decimal scale 1:9 ratio or centesimal scale 1:99 ratio. What we do, that we take the drug substance in the mortar and take the sugar of milk, that solvent by weight, that divide this mortar and sugar of milk into three equal parts. So pharmacopoeia prescribes it to in different proportions, like first one part and then three part and then five part. So this is total 9 part. Similarly, 11 part, 33 part and 55 part, that becomes 99 part. Anyway, this either way you can triangulate. So anyway, here we are dividing the drug, say sugar of milk, into three parts. So first part of that sugar of milk we take, add to the mortar and pestle, where drug was taken in the beginning. So this drug and first part of sugar of milk are now grinded for 6 minutes. Scraping is done for 3 minutes, and then 1 minute we mix it. Quickly we do it, mixing, and then this procedure we continue for next 10 minutes. So 20 minutes we finish the first part. Then go to the second part. See that here triangulation we do. Left side photo, you can see this is the manual triangulation we are doing here. Right side photo, we can see that mechanical triangulations, the mechanized triangulations we can do. Nowadays, large scale industries, they are using these mechanized triangulations. Now we come back to the triangulation procedure. Second part of the drug, second part of the sugar of milk, we add to the motor and pestle motor, and then continue the procedure for next 20 minutes. Again, 10 minutes. 10 minutes. First 10 minutes was 6 minutes grinding, 3 minutes scraping, and 1 minute mixing. 10 minutes. Again, we repeat the same procedure for another 10 minutes. So total 20 minutes. Now 40 minutes are over. Now next 20 minutes, we'll do the continue the trituration with the third part of Sugaram. Now at the end of 1 hour, we get the first trituration, and the entire procedure is followed in the same manner to prepare next trituration. Here from the first trituration, we take one part and mix with the 9 part or 99 part of Sugaram milk and keep on trituring. Again, dividing the vehicle into 3 parts, 3 equal parts, and then first 20 minutes, second 20 minutes, and third 20 minutes. We continue the trituration. At the end of 2 hours, we get the second potency. So like that, we continue and raise the potencies. Now there are lots of advantages. See, Hanuman later in his later part of his practice, he said that all the drugs should be initially triturated, and then you can develop the liquid potencies. Because this trituration, Hanuman noticed also there are so many advantages. One, first one is that it increases the surface area. It, when the surface area is increased, it facilitates absorption. The absorptive qualities of the drug of the Sugaram milk will increase, and this by the trituration, its effect also will increase. It makes the insoluble substance perfectly soluble. What was not possible, because the insoluble substances, we cannot prepare, make, manufacture any drug out of insoluble substances. By the trituration, we can do it. The insoluble substances, we can make it perfectly soluble, either in water or alcohol. You can make crude inert substance powerful, active through this trituration. We can even remove the toxicity of crude poisonous substances and make them very powerful medicines. So all kind of toxicity we can remove through these triturations. Simultaneously, there are some disadvantages also, because you know these are 1 hour. We have to continuously triturate, and it becomes only one first potency. At the end of second hour, it will be potency number 2, trituration, second trituration. Like that, 30 potency means 30 hours we have to continuously triturate. So it is very long, tiresome, laborious process, very difficult. And you know, before also I told that it is a hard substance, very difficult to pulverize them. So for them, intermixing and interchanging of drug substance will become difficult. So in that cases, hard substance, if we triturate, so the quality of the trituration may be compromised, may suffer. Even this Sugaram milk has got its aldehydic property, and because of that, it causes reduction to some substances like marker. Reductions means that not the quantitative reduction. It is oxidation and reduction, that reduction reaction. Reduction reaction it causes to marker. When soluble substances are triturated, like in the water contact is there, water exposure is there, or moisture substance we triturate, then this they will form the clumps. The molecule will develop some ionic changes during trituration. So these are the all some difficulties what we face. For few substances, these are only for exceptions. Otherwise, trituration is always good and always necessary for raising the power, for to bring out the inherent curative power of the drug substance. You must do the trituration in the beginning for all the substances, whether it is soluble or non-soluble, any substances. Some precautions we must take to avoid these difficulties, like this, you do this triturations in a dry atmosphere, warm atmosphere, in the perfectly clean, dry, odorless utensils use. Then unglazed mortar and pestle. Mortars, you know, mortar and pestle surfaces of them, contact surfaces of mortar and pestle, both are Shruti Raaf. Raaf surface helps us to grind better. If grinding will be better if surfaces are rough and unglazed. Then grind these materials systematically and symmetrically. You should to take that substance, drag and sugar of mill at the center of the mortar. Center of the mortar, and with the pestle, you go on grinding either clockwise or anti-clockwise and move from center of the mortar or from the bottom of the mortar to the periphery or to the brim of the mortar and through the clockwise or anti-clockwise in the circular motion and then return back to the center. So like that way you continuously move from the center to the periphery and from periphery to the center, from the bottom of the mortar to the brim of the mortar and again return back from the brim of the mortar to the center, either clockwise or on anti-clockwise in a circular motion with full pressure. Must keep the full pressure down. I have seen that in the manufactory, some people, those, that is why this is the, here you must understand that how the technique, homeopathic people, genuineness, why it is questioned, the genuineness of our medicines. While triturating, people just casually go on moving their pestle on the mortar very slowly, very gently, without giving any pressure. Because this is a routine work, they go on grinding, go on doing this. And this kind of trituration I have noticed in all, everywhere. All the pharmaceuticals people, they do it. Because those non-technical people, they do not know what is the exact concept of trituration, what is the necessity of this thrust and full pressure during the trituration. Even students also, you have seen that. So those here in participants, teachers must be there. They must see that the students, they are learning the correct technique, giving the full pressure and properly rotating the pestle within the mortar in a circular motion. These are all important technique which you must understand that. Then only we can properly triturate. That is why this, even if we take the triturated material and study under microscope, we can see how they are broken, how they are broken into pieces. The trituration, first potency, first trituration and second trituration, third trituration, 1C, 2C, 3C. If we take in a microscopic slide and then view through the microscope, we can see that how they are pulverized and how the particle size are changing from coarse to moderate to fine and very fine particles. So these are the drawback we see during the trituration, but does not happen many times. So this is the area where we must concentrate, then only we can improve the quality of our homeopathic medicines. Use this vessel swiftly and softly while triturating lead. Lead is a substance where we must swiftly and softly we can triturate, not too much hard pressure to give. Similarly, while triturating mercury, graphite or lead, such kind of substances, we triturate. We must give double time for the first potency. First trituration, we instead of 1 hour, we should triturate for 2 hours. For 2 hours continuously, we should triturate. Then only we will get first potency. And keep the mortar warm, because the, if it is a watery content is there, moisture is there, especially during rainy seasons, you know that this time, should motor should be kept warm, and especially when you are triturating iron, when we are preparing ferrometallicum, the medicines, motor should be kept warm. Now come to the next procedure, succussants. Succussant is a very simple technique. It's always, you can do it. Looks like very simple, but it's not so simple. As we can understand the effect of medicine, homeopathic medicine is so powerful. Succussant is a process, production of mother tincture or solution by mixing with a diluent and vigorously shaking with impact, a thrust. A particular thrust has to be given and vigorously it must be shaken. See, this diluent, normally we use alcohol and water. Water, if it is water soluble substances, at least first few potencies we must succuss, give the succussants with the water, and then we can use the alcohol. See, the nitric acid, potassium carbonate, sodium chloride, these are all water soluble substances. That is why Hellman said that 5A and 5B were water soluble substances. They are dissolved in water under the classes, and even prepared mother solutions and given the succussants also in that way. See the succussion, how it is being happening. One part by volume of mother tincture we mix with 9 parts or 99 parts depending on the scale of alcohol or water. Now, normally for lower potencies, for suppose 1x or 2x, we use dilute alcohol, and for higher potencies we use dispensing alcohol. There is a reason why we use dilute alcohol in the beginning and why you should use dispensing alcohol later. Anyway, this we take that one part of the mother tincture, and then we mix in a bottle with the 9 parts or 99 parts of alcohol, and then give 10 downward strokes. See here in this picture, you follow here. Keep your hand or the bottle in the waist height over a rubber pad, and then lift it in the 60 degree angle up to your shoulder, not up to the hand, over your head, not over your head, up to your shoulder, up to the ear lobe, up to the ear lobe, and then bring down that bottle rapidly on the rubber pad. You hit it with a thrust. So this is the one stroke, and then again take that bottle from the waist height to the point of shoulder and bring down, hit that rubber pad with a thrust, with a definite impact. So in that, like this, 10 strokes, 10, that's why it is said that 10 downward uniform strokes, 10 downward strokes of uniform strokes should be given, then we can potentize in a, of the drug, and we get the first potency. The first potency, we again take that one drop of that or one part of the first potency and mix with 9 part or 99 part of the alcohol, and then we potentize, we give the 10 strokes, give the succussions, and then we get that second potency. So like this way we continue and get the second, third and fourth or any potent number of potency we can raise. So this is one unique process of succussions. We convert the trituration into the succussion also, because you know that, as I said, that trituration, continuous trituration is very difficult. You cannot do it. So in that case, we can convert this trituration by the method of fluxion potency. We can do it. We take that one part of the 3C potency or 6X potency, mix with 50 parts of water, thoroughly mix it. Then again, we mix with 50 parts of dispensing alcohol, and then give 10 succussions. We get 4C potency, liquid potency, or 8X liquid potency. So this is now, the trituration is converted into liquid potency, and now we can raise the potencies by the process of succussions from 8X or 4C to 9X or 5C or 10X, 11X, 12X, 30X, 200X, similarly 30C, 200C, 1000C, whatever you say, all these higher potencies. So this is all about the succussions. These are the technique of triturations. So now I welcome any questions or anything. Before that, I thank everyone for listening to this session, and hope this will clear your about the concept of the potentiations, and I conclude here inviting your questions. Anything is there, any doubts, welcome.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. I would like to request everyone to please put up your questions. First, we'll discuss the questions which we have received for ma'am. Ma'am, I hope you are here with us. So, first question I would like to ask the person, Dr. Hello.
Yes, can you hear me now?
Yeah. Huh. I think sir left. Hello.
Yes, ma'am, please go on.
Yeah, so first question was, is there any Dr. Sayyed Husseini, is there a place for placebo for a homeopath treating another homeopath?
I didn't get the question, ma'am.
Ma'am, the person is asking for a placebo when he is treating another homeopath.
When he is treating another homeopath?
Yeah.
But that homeopath is a patient, right?
Yeah.
That's it. So he can use it.
So without telling, no?
Of course. I told you. It is between the physician and the physician. Because he decides whether the placebo needs to be given or not. So tomorrow, if the front person is a homeopath or an allopath or anybody, patient is a patient matter. So the patient requires, he needs to do it.
Okay, ma'am, thank you. There is one more question from Dr. Nagaraj Patil. He's saying ki you said placebo produces a psychological effect on adults.
It's neurological, yeah.
What about the children? Hello?
In children, yes. Can you hear me, ma'am?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Now, it's a very good question, I feel, because going through many pediatric journals, I've seen that still it is a part of controversy. But still, as far as I know, it is the parental attitude what works. About 86% of the parents are for giving the placebo to the child. We can give placebo to the children in cases required. It will definitely help, but not without the help or the cooperation of the parents.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. There is one more question. Dr. Santosh Kumar has asked, what are the biggest factors contributing to the placebo effect?
I think I have explained this in my slides, but we would definitely go once again. Mind is everything. When we speak about the psychobiological effect, here the mind speaks. So it is all mind oriented. I can tell you one thing, the more a patient wants the treatment, the more is he going to have the placebo effect upon himself. The more he wants the treatment to be done, the more stronger is the desire to be treated for, the more will he get affected by the placebo. So it's biological effect. A psychobiological effect where the patient has got a satiety, a pleasing attitude within himself. So it's all mind oriented. That is why Dr. Hanuman has conspicuously given only in certain cases where it is required, not always.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. There is one more question from Dr. Harsh Sharma. Can we mix solid placebo with liquid placebo or not?
Well, it's a nice question. When we are taking our practicals, madam, during that time, we have a practical for preparation of doses. So here, at times, we take one scruple or one grain of sugar of milk. We take one poppy seed globule. And we add one drop or 1 minute of dispensing alcohol into it. So we can add the sugar of milk and the dispensing alcohol, that is the liquid and the solid together, and give it to the patient.
Thank you, ma'am. There are a few more questions, why homeopathic aggravations are being seen.
Homeopathic aggravation is basically a very big question of stalwarts of medicine. But still, I would like to just say a few lines about it, that when a curative, it's basically a curative action. So when a homeopathic curative remedy is given to the patient, a slight knowing unknowing aggravation is created as a part of response. Sometimes the patient may feel it, sometimes the patient may not feel it. So slight worsening of the symptoms, that is the homeopathic aggravation.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. I think sir is also with us. Sir, yes. Am I audible to you?
Yes, yeah. yes, ma'am. I'm here.
Sir, there is a question for you from yes. Dr. Shiva Sarvanan. Sir is asking, is there any instrument to study the kinetic action of drug?
Right,
I think
now,
he left.
Yes, right now there are lots of researches are going on. That potentizations of kinetic actions, and you know that IIT Mumbai, and they are using some of the instruments. Even that Wawa Atomic Research Center, they are also using some of the centers, some of the potentized medicines analyzer, and they are finding that nanoparticles, and they are also research and experiments with that. So there are machines we can study
okay,
the kinetic actions of the drug.
Yes, Dr. Rajesh.
Yes. I think we lost the connection with Dr. Pal. So
no, he's audible. Yeah.
I'm sorry. Because he's not audible to me. It's okay. If in case he's live on the platform, kindly continue, please.
Yeah.
Yes. It's okay. I have already concluded that it's machines available to study the kinetic actions, and we can very well do it. We can do it. Any other questions?
Thank you, sir. Yes, there is one more question from Dr. Kashike Dwivedi. He is asking, crude state or large doses can bring instantaneous harm and may be fatal, but in more potentized form, the increased potency, and it must be more effective and most fatal too. Can you please explain this?
This is that I can tell you one story better. You can understand that by this story. You must have heard that Ramakrishna Paramahansa and Swami Vivekananda. This, I hope that this story may not be relevant to this platform. Anyways, I share this story. This is Swami Vivekananda was, when he was a child, his name was Narendranath Datta. Then Ramakrishna Paramahansa, one day he called him, this Narendranath Datta, to meet him, to meet Ramakrishna. But what happened is Narendranath Datta was a great atheist. He never believed in God, never believed. And since he did not want to meet, but his friends continuously insisted to go to meet Ramakrishna and share his experience or meet him and what he wants to say just to speak to him. But with lots of disagreement and lots of dissatisfaction, he went to meet Ramakrishna. And then in the first meeting, he didn't believe or he didn't care Ramakrishna. And then Ramakrishna just touched Vivekananda, this Narendranath Datta. Then he felt like just electric flickering like electric current. Since second time, he touched for a little longer time. He felt that sensation is much more stronger. Then he started thinking, what is happening? Whenever this man is touching him, and this is happening. Then third time, then he went, and that time Ramakrishna touched him for much little more longer time, few minutes, and then Narendranath Datta fainted. When he rose up, he got up, he regained his consciousness, he became Swami Vivekananda. That is the changes Ramakrishna brought to the boy Narendranath Dutt, because his impurities, his toxicity from his mind, everything went away by the divine touch of Ramakrishna. This is just potentization. Here, this by this potentization, we are removing all the toxicity, all these poisonous things from the immanent, by the immanent force of the dynamic power of the this simple technique, and we potentize to raise to that level where this drug substance is totally pure, fully pure, and it works like that in the energetic form. As I said, that example, how Swami Vivekananda, you know that how what he did was his activities in the later part of the world, later part. So that same way, this enormous energy emerged in the minds of Vivekananda. So same way, these potentized medicines also behave like that, act like that, just like an energy form in the capsule, energy form in a small few globules. Whatever globules we see, it's a sugarcane balls, but it is full of energy. So that is how this, we can eliminate all the toxicity, and we can make them into pure energetic form. That's all.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. I think this clearly shows how much knowledgeable, and as ma'am said in the beginning of the session, while we were discussing, that you being spiritual always, and thank you so much for guiding us. There is one more question from Dr. Sharmishtha Bhattacharji. She's asking significance of jumping potency.
Jumping potency is, as I said, that is its trituration. We know that it's a tiresome, laborious process. We cannot just go on triturating. If you can triturate, it's better, but you know, human labor, it is not possible. Even through the machine also, we cannot go on just raising the potency by trituration, and it is time taking also. See that 1 hour it is required for one potency to raise the trituration, but sakkasan just within a few, 1 minute, within minute 10 sakkasans you can do. So this significance of this jumping potency, the 6x to 8s, is just dissolving the triturated substance into the liquid form. Only up to 3c we have to triturate, or 6x you can triturate. From there, before 3c or before 6x, it cannot be dissolved. Till that time you have to triturate, because neither it will be dissolved in water nor in alcohol or any other liquid mediums. So you need to triturate up to 3c or 6x potency, and then you can dissolve it into liquid. It will be well dissolved, and you can raise the further potencies by the process of sakkasan, which is much more easier, simple, and taking short time, consumes less time, very less time. That's all. Anything?
I think we have a question from ma'am as well. This is placebo from Dr. Manisha Deshmukh. Placebo, sugar of milk itself can cause some symptoms. So how to differentiate whether it is a drug reaction of SL or just a psychological effect of placebo?
Usually it is very difficult for us to cite a type of reaction from sugar of milk, because it's absolutely a very safe vehicle to be given. In fact, we give it to the babies as a part of their diet. So it's a very rare, happening that the sugar of milk can give some type of reaction. Then I think so we need to reorganize and retake the case properly and see whether there is any lactose intolerance or something that way. Otherwise, we have never been able to find such type of saccharum lactase reaction or some type of hypersensitivity to saccharum lactase. It might be some type of lactose intolerance, I feel.
Thank you, ma'am. I think we have more questions from people. I would like to request them to ask the speakers personally on the mail. Right now, I'm typing the mail ID of Dr. Aarti for everybody to contact.
I have already broadcasted on my, ma'am, I saw.
I was just updating everybody so that they do not face any problem. I would also update the email ID of Dr. Prawas.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So that you can discuss all your queries personally with them. It is for Dr. Aarti, you can use arati@gmail.com.
Yes.
And
yes,
for Prawaspal sir, you can use Prawaskarpal@gmail.com.
Yes, yes.
So guys, I have already typed it. You can use it because we are, I think we should wind up this session. We have more questions coming. I request Dr. Kashik K. Dwivedi also to contact them on email personally. If you face any issue, you can contact me at webinar@homeopathy360.com anytime, and all your queries will be solved. So I think we come to the end of the session today. And before ending this session, first of all, I would like to thank our esteemed speakers who have been with us today, and they have taken such a great session and wonderful revision of placebo as well as potentization, which is a weak part of every homeopath, I would say, but yes, maximum homeopaths. So this is a good revision as for me as well, and I hope everybody must have enjoyed it. Thank you, our esteemed speakers. Thank you, Dr. Aarti. Thank you, Dr. Prawas, for being with us and giving your valuable time to our team, as well as guiding the audience and teaching them with your knowledge. So thank you, ma'am, and thank you, sir, on behalf of whole team 360. My heartfelt thanks also goes to all our learners who have been with us today. And before I sign off today, a very, very important vote of thanks must also go to the people who are behind our team, Homeopathy 360. Yes, it's team Homeopathy 360 that works day in and out to bring you all information related to homeopathy and make you updated at www.homeopathy360.com. We have upcoming webinars also coming, which we'll be updating you through our website as well as our social portals. We'll be lining up our webinars in the coming week soon, and we'll be informing you for the future webinars. Also, we'll try to share the recorded version of this webinar as well on our YouTube channel, Homeopathy 360. We would love to hear from you if you have any suggestions or any thing you want to discuss with us, or we welcome you if anybody want to contribute their knowledge or share their knowledge to the fraternity through our portal. And this comes to the end. I would like to thank Dr. Rajesh as well as Mr. Manish Jain for being with us and always being there behind the scenes to manage everything. So 5 metrics for measuring this webinar success. Thank you everyone for taking out time and being here today. If you have any queries, mail us at webinar@homeopathy360.com. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Aarti. Thank you, audience. Thank you, Dr. Yashika. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Yeah.